I'm Michael Brown. I'm a professor of logistics and urban freight transport at the University of Gothenburg. For most of my career, I've worked in London at the University of Westminster, and I'm very involved in urban freight research, working a lot with policymakers and other people who are concerned with making better decisions about how we deal with urban freight. In fact, I've continued to work very closely with Urban Freight because I chair the Central London Freight Quality Partnership, which brings me into contact with people from the Central London boroughs, Transport for London, and I'll explain a bit more about them in a moment, as well as operators of freight transport vehicles, retailers, and some of the associations that represent all those organisations. I want to tell you a bit about the importance of urban freight, and then I'm going to say something about urban freight developments in London from a number of different perspectives. Maybe if I can start about the importance of urban freight, I think we tend to overlook what a significant part of the total traffic flow it is. For example, in London during the peak, around 30% of the traffic is actually a freight vehicle, a truck or a van. And in fact, of those two, vans are more significant than trucks. They're about 10% and the trucks are 6%. And in London, freight is mainly a road-based phenomenon. Around about up to 90% of all the freight that's being delivered in London takes place on the road network. So it's really important to think about how road transport contributes both to the wealth of London, to the services and to the industry of London, but also the problems it can cause when it's part of this big movement on the road network, morning, night, evening, and at the same time as many other people are using the network. I think there's a lot of things that companies can do in order to improve the way that they manage their freight systems, both in terms of how they consolidate the flows and how they retime deliveries. If we can move the deliveries out of the peak period, then we can get some significant benefits in terms of efficiencies of each freight movement on the road network. So each truck or van can have a better journey, less time spent in congestion, and be more effective and efficient in terms of what it's doing in the logistics chain. In London, there's been a number of initiatives and experiments about retiming freight movements, just as there have been in other cities around the world. I think the second thing that we can think about is how to consolidate flows. Again, in London, we've seen a lot of initiatives taken to consolidate flows, whether that's physically by using some kind of consolidation centre, or whether it's a more organisational feature, whereby we change the way we buy or purchase products as a business, and by buying in a bundled procurement style, we manage to group together flows and put them in the same vehicle to make the delivery to a particular point. I think partnership is at the heart of what's possible in terms of freight transport in the city. And London's no exception to that. It has a big freight's important in London. It's a difficult city for operators to work in. It's very busy. The peak time is very peaked. And we do need to think about how working in partnership between the public and private sector, and within that between different kind of authorities and institutions and businesses, how can that all work together? And this notion of freight partnerships is something that was created in the UK way back now, in the late 1990s. And actually they've been taken up by a number of organisations. In London, we've got the Central London Freight Quality Partnership, as we call it. And that's something which, as I said in the introduction, I chair. And on that freight partnership, we have businesses like retailers, John Lewis, for example, and we have transport companies like DHL. And we also have the Central London boroughs. So that's the local areas within Central London, Westminster, Camden, the city, and so on. And they meet together four times a year, discuss problems, share solutions, and work out what they can do. In fact, there's a video clip that we've got of that and about how some of this came about and the history of this freight partnership.
Tell us a little bit about the Central London Freight Partnership, though, yeah. And how that grew up, because that I think that's a useful lesson for for other places where, as you suggested, the challenges are similar.
Well, it started from an idea that arose in Britain anyway, back in the late 1990s, which was that the city authorities or local authorities needed to get together with businesses and talk to each other more because they just didn't understand each other's position very well from the public sector and the private sector. And so this idea of having freight quality partnerships in cities and even in towns around Britain grew up. And in about the mid, I suppose in about 2005 in London, they thought, well, wouldn't it be good to have one in the centre? So it brings together the Central London boroughs So that's a number of them that come together in the centre, like Westminster, the City, Kensington and Chelsea, others around there. They come together to discuss freight-related issues with, if you like, their opposite numbers in the private sector, from retailing, from the carriers like UPS, DHL, and also then with other interested groups. So we have a freight transport association that represents the industry and so on. So they've been coming together since 2006. I chaired it when it was set up, and I've carried on doing that. And they've come together to talk four times a year about what are the problems, what can they do, can they work together on some solutions, and in a way also to say, well, what's the gap between the public and private sector? Because I know we talked a little bit about what we would discuss today, and I said to you that I think at the first meeting which I chaired of this group, I thought, oh great, I'm, you know, an academic, I'm getting involved with this group of people, this will be a good discussion. And in fact, I mean, it would be better if I was a referee, really, because there was a lot of animosity about the parking fines for being in, penalties for being in the wrong place. And so over time, that's really, the discussion's changed a lot, and people are able to listen better to each other's point of view and think about where maybe they can join it up a little bit more.
The discussions have gotten better, but have the challenges become even more problematic with the advent of e-commerce and the fact that now each of us as an individual consumer is one of those stakeholders that has to be considered?
I think that's a very good point. I think that, you know, it has got better, but at the same time, we've got just as many, if not more, challenges. The whole way that cities, in the time that it's been running, people have become much more aware that the population of London, for instance, is growing quite significantly. That we've got big infrastructure projects happening across London, which take up a lot of road capacity and put challenges out there for the transport operators that have to serve the businesses that they're working with. And at the same time as that, we've got this rise in e-commerce, delivery to homes and also delivery to offices for people's personal products, which are quite often going to the office buildings for that. And so, yeah, there's just as many things to solve in 2017 as there were in 2006.
If not more.
And my hope would be that maybe the good thing would be that we're a bit better at least having a good dialogue about how could we get to a discussion that's more meaningful about them. I think for Transport for London, the Olympics was the Olympics was a big challenge. And how to cope with all the different flows of people and freight during the Olympics was something that received a lot of attention. Transport for London are the strategic authority for London, and they're responsible at the transport level for the underground or metro system, for buses, for regulating taxis, and also for the control of the strategic route network, which is around about 5% of the road network, but carries something like 40% of all the traffic in London. The Olympics meant that all of these networks were disrupted in different ways, and the effect on freight was quite significant because they couldn't make deliveries at the same time, they had to change the way they were operating, they had to reroute in some cases, they had to think about the mode of transport they would use. In some cases, companies changed over to walking with the freight. A lot of change. I think the key thing for Transport for London in this was that they had to engage with the freight community, and they did that very successfully in the run-up to the Olympic Games. And that engagement with the freight community showed just what was possible, because in fact they managed to achieve significant retiming, they managed to achieve more consolidated flows, and in doing that they learned a lot about how to get trust from the freight industry and to work with them in a partnership style. And this continued after the Olympic Games, and in fact has gone on until now. And in Transport for London still work very actively with the industry in a number of initiatives which they've got, which include a meeting of the so-called London Freight Forum, which meets four times a year.